Hi guys, welcome to another episode of Watch and Roll. Today we're going to talk about the misconception of what defines a good Bessel action. So what makes a good Bessel action? How do we know it's something objective instead of an opinion? Well, let me tell you that the way the human brain works when it comes to perception. For example, when we say what's good music, what's good food, what's bad food, there is real objective points of reference in all of this, but when it comes to relative perception, it all boils down to psychological conditioning. In other words, our brain unconsciously makes connections between pleasing experiences and emotions with things like music, taste, smells, and even Bessel actions. So I can confidently say, when it comes to Bessel actions, there's a lot of biased opinions. If we get opinions out of the way and we only keep objective elements, what do we look for on a good Bessel action? Well, I would say we look for number one, the confidence of the Bessel action. This can translate as solidity. For example, if there is little to no gap between the case and the Bessel, this talks about the precision behind the production. Number two, I think alignments, if the Bessel markings align properly. Number three could be a good level of resistance in relation to smoothness. We don't want a very hard to turn Bessel, but we don't want it loose neither. Number four, a click that is not dead and is not too loud neither. How about the clicky feeling of the detents? Well, this is a little relative. For example, one of the most misunderstood Bessel actions are Seiko Bessel actions. On Swiss divers, you tend to find Bessel actions with a certain construction that gives a feeling of sharp detents. They are sometimes very clicky, and that's okay for the type of Bessel system. On Seikos and Orients and other Japanese watches, you often find a different system which is more of a gliding mechanism, and they actually developed that system so the Bessel doesn't get stuck when debris gets inside. We have found some people saying, this 2K Seiko Diver has a bad Bessel action, when actually I have tried the same watch and I thought it was such a nice Bessel action. The argument behind this is often the following. Number one, it has a lot of play. Number two, it doesn't align. Okay, so Japanese divers glide freely. They don't have the stationary detents like Swiss divers do. This is not a feature of poor quality. In fact, what is having play is, for example, on my Oris Aquis, when you turn the Bessel, you align it to a specific place, then the Bessel will move back. Sort of a spraying action, and between each detent you could feel this play, not really giving you the freedom to place it exactly where you want it. On Seiko divers, this is very different because the Bessel doesn't move back. The Bessel will stay exactly where you left it. Of course, if you move it back purposely, you can probably find play. But this doesn't matter at all functionally because the Bessel is actually staying where you left it. The Bessel is not moving by itself. And the system is meant to be like that. It was not designed with such detents. It glides. In my personal preference, this is nicer because by letting it gliding, you're deleting the play. The Bessel is not moving by itself. You have to actually move it with your hand. And I sometimes see these people moving a Seiko Bessel, aligning it to the minute marker, then pulling it back. It is really strange to me. There's no need for that. This is my theory of why Seiko divers could get this bad reputation. You could find these Bessel systems on $200 Seikos. And if you experience this on a low-end Seiko diver, your mind will connect the Bessel action feeling with low-end watches. So when you come to a 1500 Seiko, you find the same system and you are expecting something different, perhaps something like you will find on a $1,500 Swiss diver. Well, actually, in my own experience, in all higher-end Japanese divers, even though the Bessel system is similar to the low-end, the Bessel smoothness and solidity always feels more refined. I made a video comparing the Oris Aquis and the Seiko Marine Master Tuna. I can tell you very honestly, between these two Bessel actions, the one that inspired more confidence for me, it was the Seiko, because The Oris Aqua is had unintended play. It will move by itself. If I set it to a certain place, the vessel sometimes will go back like a spring. It takes away from the purpose. It's not letting you to precisely set the vessel. And the Seiko would stay anywhere you set it to. Vessels on Seikos don't really have the tents to pull back to. This is another reason why it doesn't really matter if the tents of the Seiko align with the markers. But even that, if I set the vessel and pull it back, it does align, at least on my Seiko Marine Master Tuna. I don't doubt there could be Seikos with unaligned detents. It's very well known that Seikos have a bad reputation for misaligned chapter rings. One of the nicest vessel actions I can find is on the Tudor Pelagos. The vessel system is designed to have a very defined detent. It is a different system than Seikos or Orion's. But Tudor does it super well because those detents have very little play. A tiny play should always be acceptable because that's the reason why it can move to the next detent. It is rather silly to say, well, it has the little play, like if it's a negative thing. It all depends on the system, but it is natural to have a tiny play, even on very tight vessels. The vessel is allowed to move to get to the next click. It will have to be a very hard to turn vessel to not have any play. It's sort of like saying, well, this leg has some flex when it bends. Of course, it's designed to pivot and move. So yeah, it is bad when there's a lot of play and on purposely. It is bad when the vessel has more play than the distance between each minute marker or between each click. Now, I'd like you to tell me what's the nicest vessel action you've ever tried. For me, personally, it has been the Tudor Pelagos, the Rolex Submariner, and number one, in my personal opinion, any Grand Seiko diver would do it. Okay guys, let me know. I'll see you later.